Well, thanks very much for inviting me. As Ralph said, I'm a historian of globalization, which also means that I'm a historian of deglobalization. So in answer to a question that was asked in the first session, is globalization reversible? Yes, of course it is, because it's been reversed on several occasions in the past. I want to make a few preliminary points and then go on and talk about some bits of history that are maybe particularly relevant for us today. First of all, I think I agree with what was said earlier by other speakers. I think it's too early to speak of deglobalization as having already happened. Simon Evanett and his colleagues in St. Gallen have done a wonderful job documenting various non-tariff barriers that have emerged since 2008, but this is not at all comparable with the deglobalization that we saw in the interwar period. This is what deglobalization really looks like. These are average price gaps between agricultural commodities in different markets, indexed to 100 in 1913. So you can see that markets disintegrated as measured by rising price gaps across World War I. There was a reintegration, very gradual, during the 1920s, and then everything goes to hell. And everything goes to hell because tariff barriers are rising, quotas are imposed all over the place, exchange controls are imposed all over the place, and so on. And we haven't seen anything like this yet. Now, Brexit, I think, is going to be different. If the Brits get the hard Brexit that they say they want a hard Brexit, they want to leave the customs union, they want to leave the single market, then, of course, there will be disintegration. And if they fall over the cliff edge, which is entirely likely, then we'll get even more disintegration. And as an educator, I would say perhaps that this will be very educational if they jump over the cliff edge. The only problem is that at the bottom of the cliff is my own country, Ireland, and we risk getting squashed. And the economic consequences of that are the least of our worries. They would be catastrophic, actually. But, I mean, actually, the real consequences for us of that have to do with national security, and they're existential, and the government has red lines, and it can't afford to compromise on those red lines. We cannot have a border returning in Ireland. Second point, this question about that you often hear about whether anti-globalization forces today, or populism, whether these have economic or cultural causes, that question itself has become extraordinarily ideological. It's very difficult for some people on the left, especially in America, to acknowledge that some of those Trump voters might have been voting their pocketbook, might have had economic grievances, because I think in some sense, if you admit that, you're justifying the vote, and that, I understand, can be difficult to admit if you're on the left in America, faced with this abomination that is Trump. Simultaneously, if you ask people who are in favor of Brexit, they often will say it's terrible, we care about these poor workers and so on. They'll find it very difficult to admit that xenophobia and chauvinism was also an important component part of that vote. The only sensible answer to the question whether it's culturally economic is that it's both. I think that's pretty obvious. Myself and Danny, with respective co-authors about 20 years ago, looked at attitudes towards globalization in rich and poor countries, and we found, both of us, that in rich countries, but not in poor countries, unskilled workers were much more protectionist than skilled workers, which is consistent with economic self-interest mattering for the reasons that David was talking about. But we also found that other things mattered. So here's a bunch of questions that these people were asked. Do you think that Switzerland is the best country in the world? Do you think that people who aren't Swiss are a little bit dodgy? And if you correlate these responses to these questions with attitudes towards globalization, of course you find that the more likely you are to answer yes to these questions, the more hostile to trade you are. Now, back then, in the early noughties, when I presented these sorts of findings, economists would say to me, ah, yes, but the nationalism must be endogenous to the economic interests. If people hate foreigners, it must be because they're being hurt by the foreigners. Today, people are often arguing that the perception that people are voting their pocketbook is actually a mirage, and that it's only xenophobia that is at work here. And I think it's sensible to conclude that both could be at work simultaneously. A final point just aimed at my fellow economists here. As social scientists, we're trained to look for structural explanations for things like Brexit and Trump. Deep structural interests, deep structural explanations, be they economic or non-economic. But my historian part of me does want to emphasize that there's always a role for chance and contingency in explaining these phenomena. And, well, as a Catholic, I suppose I believe in free will. And I don't think we should let our politicians off the hook either, because they always have free will. They always can make choices, and those choices matter for better or for worse. Now, there are two phases of deglobalization that I think are particularly relevant to today. The first is the late 19th century, which saw a very dramatic globalization that was ultimately technological in origin. The solid line there is an index of transport costs, freight rates, shipping rates, the cost of transporting stuff into Britain. But shipping rates were falling everywhere because of the steamship, and railroads were linking the interiors of new continents to the ports. So that's the technological shock that sets everything going. It's the equivalent of China opening up to markets today. And when that happens, you see a very dramatic increase in shipments of things like grain across the Atlantic. That's the dotted line. And you also see a collapse in the price gap between, you know, expensive wheat in England and cheap wheat on the prairies. That price gap falls. And so in Europe, you have cheap imports of wheat. And guess what? Farmers lose. And farmers see their incomes decline. And guess what? Where they have the power to do something about it, they do something about it. And they lobby their governments and they get agricultural protection. And very often this becomes protection for manufacturing as well. So in France, in Germany, in Sweden, in Italy, you get a systematic move away from free trade, starting sometime in the late 1870s, going through the 1890s. So this is a very clear case of globalization undermining itself because it created winners and losers, and the losers have political voice, and they exercise that voice. On the other side of the Atlantic, you have something similar happening, also regarding trade, but also regarding immigration. And what you see in America and Argentina and Brazil and so on is, again, you get a gradual tightening of immigration restrictions. And that can be correlated and is correlated with rising wage inequality in those societies. And so I would argue that there is something economic going on there. But equally clearly, if you look at the obsessive focus on Asian immigration, there was clearly more than just economic interests at play. There was also racism at work there as well. Now, what's to be done about this kind of anti-globalization backlash driven by continents with very different factor endowments, very cheap land and very expensive land, or very cheap unskilled labor and very expensive unskilled labor as we have today? What's to be done about this source of anti-globalization backlash? And history can provide us with answers. Very strikingly, it's during this first age of globalization that you get the beginnings of the welfare state in Europe. You get unemployment insurance, sickness insurance, old age pensions, and so on. If any of you have Irish ancestors, I would encourage you to look at the censuses which are online in 1901 and 1911. And you'll find that on average, your ancestors age by more than 10 years between those two census dates. And that's because the old age pension came in 1908 and everybody suddenly realized that they were older than they had always thought they were. But of course, this can play a useful role, as we know, in making people feel okay about the market. And what's striking is that in countries that were more exposed to globalization, countries that were smaller and more open, Belgium, the Scandinavian countries, that's precisely where these social protections were introduced the most. There wasn't a race to the bottom at this point. If anything, there was a race to the top. I always like to bring up the example of the 1904 treaty between France and Italy. There was a very modern dilemma. Italians were going to France and were benefiting from French insurance policies, and the French didn't like this. And so they did a deal, and the deal was the Italians can continue to come to France on condition that the Italians bring in the same social protections as we have in France. A very sensible solution to a problem. You can have a levelling up rather than a levelling down if that's what the politicians want. The interwar period, oh yes, and by the way, this is since we have Danny in the audience, he found something similar using, I think, 1980s data. As of the 1980s, it was also the case that more open countries had bigger governments. And this can be seen in a and interpreted in a political light. You have more openness, and so you have more demand for social insurance, and that's what the governments provide. Interwar period. That's not got to do with a long drawn out shift in comparative advantage. It's a sudden sharp financial shock driven largely by catastrophic macroeconomic policy linked to the gold standard. The red lines are interest rates during our recent economic crisis. They did all fall eventually, even in the Eurozone. The other lines are what happened to interest rates during the Great Depression. And as you can see, they didn't fall by very much. This is what happened to government budget deficits during this period. This is a government budget deficits in a sample of countries as a share of GDP. The red lines are the 3% criteria. God knows why I would care about 3% of GDP budget deficits, but in Europe we care about this. And the good news is that during the Great Depression, everybody hit their Maastricht targets. They all hit their 3% budget deficit targets. But of course, that was absolutely catastrophic news, because if you're in the middle of the Great Depression, your tax revenues are collapsing, you need to spend more money. If you want to hit a target like this, you're going to have to tighten like mad. And that helped exacerbate the crisis everywhere. What was to be done was to leave the gold standard. This is one of the most famous pictures in economic history. It shows you what happened to industrial production in a series of countries. And what you can see is that they recover at different times. So the British leave the gold standard in 1931. They start to recover. The Germans and the Americans, with their shiny new leaders, rather different, leave the gold standard in 1933 and start to recover. The French, who thought about macroeconomics in a sort of Teutonic way back then, only left the gold standard in 1936, and that's when they started to recover. And it was in the countries that stuck to gold the longest and thus suffered the sharpest Great Depressions that the switch to protection was the highest. This is just a picture taken from work by Barry Eichengreen and Doug Irwin. It shows that quotas were much more resorted to in the gold standard countries than in countries like Britain that moved to more rational macroeconomic policies earlier on. You know, get the macroeconomics right and all sorts of really bad things can happen. And of course, quotas weren't the worst of it. There were even worse political consequences in countries like Germany. So what was to be done? Improve your macroeconomic policy, but more generally, what was to be done was to bring the state in to provide the security that during this particular decade, capitalism on its own was not providing to people. This is the cover of a wonderful book by Sherry Berman, and the cover tells the story that she tells in the book, or it's one of the main messages of the book. So here are two very similar election posters. In Germany, they want Arbeit und Brot, and in Sweden, they want, what do they want? Arbeit, same word, and an Ölkupkraft, or however they pronounce it up there in Sweden. So they want higher purchasing power. In other words, they want bread, yes? So one of the many tragedies in Weimar Germany is that it wasn't the Social Democrats that was putting this message forward, because the Social Democrats then were still Marxists. And actually, they wanted capitalism to collapse. And so they certainly weren't going to rescue it. In Sweden, by contrast, the Social Democrats had already made the transition to being properly Social Democrats, which meant that they actually had policies to propose. And everywhere in Europe where Democrats proposed policies that safeguarded private property, that, you know, were not communist, but that involved the state doing more stuff to hate ordinary people, those guys all did fantastically well. Democratic politicians, as different as the Swedish Democrats or, say, Eamon de Valera in Ireland, they all did fabulously well during this period. And of course, the communists understood that their real enemy was social democracy, which was a fundamentally conservative political program, because it was a way of saving capitalism from its own consequences and thus undermining the demand for political protectionism, whether on the right or the left. Okay, and so we know what happened then. There's a post-war construct, Keynesian macroeconomics, social democratic welfare states, and those are eroded from the 70s or 80s. Here's a quote to end with from a book that I wrote with Jeff Williamson in 99, and it's saying, be careful because globalization has undermined itself in the late 19th century. It could happen again. The point I want to make is that we were not prophetic. Danny had already written a book 2 years previously saying, watch out, folks. But even more importantly, in the 1990s, there was already a huge debate about whether rising wage inequality in rich countries was due to trade or technology. They had exactly the same debate then that we have now. And that was understandable, because it was already 20 years since median wages had stopped rising in the United States. You know, they stopped rising sometime between Saturday Night Fever and the Sex Pistols' first LP. I mean, it was a long, long time ago. This was a crisis that was a long time coming. We'd already had Ross Perot, we'd already had Pat Buchanan, you know, After this book, we already had, you know, 2005, the French referendum. It ended up being a referendum about markets and globalization, and we know what the consequences were. And the same class divides happened as happened in Brexit and happened with Trump. Finally, let me go back to this important point that was made in the opening talk about political leadership, because it isn't just structure that matters, agency matters as well. We have choices. And let me make a comparison between Britain and Ireland. We have, in Ireland, actually more Eastern Europeans per capita than the Brits. But we don't have the same media, number one. And number two, we have an extremist nationalist party, Sinn Féin. They're not choir boys, right? They were justifying murder, you know, up to the early 1990s. I mean, if anybody should have taken on an anti-immigrant stance, it should have been Sinn Féin. But for whatever reason, they chose not to do that. Maybe it was principle, maybe it was, yeah, maybe it was cynical positioning, but whatever the reason, that's what they did. And therefore, even though there was a latent tension concerning these rapid immigrant inflows that was manifested, for example, in the first referendum on the first Lisbon Treaty, that tension had no political outlet to go to. And the result is that we have a politics that absolutely is not anti-immigrant now. It's a much healthier politics than in Britain. So we always have choices, and especially politicians have choices. Finally, Europe. What's Europe about? Why do we have Europe? It was always about reconciling the state and the market. It was about having trade at a continental level, but not having races to the bottom. That's the whole point. That's why we have this incredibly complicated superstructure. The French were arguing for this from day one. And if you think about the China shock, and you think about the need to have enough market to maintain a political support for openness, I mean, this is surely Europe's moment, although perhaps it would be helpful if it was a small country person rather than the French president who was saying so, because that would maybe be easier to sell around the continent. That's all.